Hey friends, this is Pastor Jeremy. I've been thinking a lot about the subject of shame. Shame is a subject that's gotten a lot of attention around the world due to the research of Dr. Brené Brown. She's done some brilliant research on the subject and has really brought a lot of great points about shame and the destructive consequences of shame to light. Shame is a subject that's been talked about in the recovery community for decades. And shame is also a subject that the faith communities and religious communities within Christianity have also addressed. Unfortunately, it's also been something that the religious communities have excelled in propagating and perpetrating. And that's got to change. I'm a firm believer that shame is more destructive than beneficial. To me, the definition of shame, basically, if I were describing shame to someone I was talking to, I would say shame says, hey, you're bad, there's nothing good about you, there's no hope for your life, you are completely evil, completely rotten to the core, there's nothing redeemable about you, and there's no hope for your life. You are consigned to whatever life you live because of what you've done. You are evil. You don't deserve to get better. To me, that's completely contrary to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I am not going to participate in shame any longer. I have seen the destructive consequences of shame brutally beaten into people from the pulpit. And I've also seen shame as something that people hold against themselves. And recently I've talked a little bit about forgiveness and about perfectionism and about making yourself available to God. But shame is one of those things that block you from experiencing intimate relationship with God. And shame is something that can be defeated through self-forgiveness. I don't believe that God's in the shaming business. And I've got a scriptural proof text that I think you'll find interesting. Romans 8:1 says that there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. In fact, all 39 verses of Romans 8 talk about the tension that exists between the lusts of the flesh and the desires of the spirit. And if we yield to the spirit, we do not have to enter into shame or fleshly carnal living and thinking. And that is clearly delineated in Romans chapter 8 verses 1 through 39. Paul's very explicit on that subject. However, you know, in talking about grace and the effect of grace on shame, I think that grace enables us. You could say it's the presence of God, the power of God, the dunamis power of God, that enables us to defeat shame. Shame has an inner voice. Shame is one of the members at this little committee that lives inside of our head. It's like a little board of directors inside of our head that weighs in on almost every experience we have. And we cannot afford to live under the influence of shame, whether it's past or present. Now, if we have sinned, if we have done something that we feel alienates us from God, God has made a pathway through confession and through repentance. Repentance is a change of mind, an absolute change of mind. And I pray, friends, that grace would change your mind about the shame and the feelings of shame that you've carried. There are a lot of voices of accusation that perpetrate and promote shame within our lives. Those are the voices that we've got to turn the volume down on. We need to surround ourselves with people that believe in us and see us from God's point of view. Yes, there are people that are more interested in pointing out your sin and your flaws. There are people that are interested in holding you hostage to your past. Those are not the people that are really qualified and called to disciple you, because they're really what they're doing is they're pointing out the stuff in your life that they deny the existence of within their own life. And it's like scripture says, you can point out the speck in my eye as long as you acknowledge the log that's in yours. And it's all about the filters and the lenses that we choose to perceive one another and our own lives through. I choose to look at my life from God's point of view. My faith is what God knows to be true about me. That inspires my belief in His goodness and that He is truly interested in my well-being and my welfare, that He is not sitting up on His throne somewhere in the heavenly realm, obsessing about everything that I'm doing wrong, taking personal offense like everybody on Facebook and then posting it. No, God isn't like us. I don't think God spends all of his time in offense. I don't think God spends all of his time on the throne worried and obsessing about us following all the little rules we've created for ourselves. I think that God is genuinely interested in who we are, and that when he looks at us, he sees us in Christ. He sees us through that filter. And when he looks at you, he loves you. When he looks at me, he loves me. He doesn't see something he's disgusted by. When he looks at me, I don't believe that he's disgusted by me. You know, if he's disgusted by anything, it would be that I've settled for a lower life, a lower quality of life than what the cross of Christ has secured for me. I think that's pretty much the truth. You know, when God looks at me, he doesn't shame me. In fact, he's not even provoking and triggering much guilt. I think when there's a deep sense of inner conviction about my thought life or some behavior or activity I'm engaging in, he throws up a little blip on the radar to make sure that I understand that I'm crossing boundaries and violating values. I'm doing things that distance me and distract me from who he is within me and who he is in my life. And you know what? I'm completely in process with all of this. My theology is going through a massive upheaval and a radical upgrade in grace. So I hope that as I continue to grow, that my views mature and evolve and grow in grace, because I don't want to participate in shame. Shame is destructive, and it takes courage to rebel against shame. You've got to lead a rebellion against your own status quo thinking in most regards. Excuse me. We've got to rebel against our most dominant thoughts, because our lives always move in the direction of our most dominant thoughts. Take inventory of what your thoughts are. Do a prayer of examine. Write down all the negative thoughts that you have about yourself. Those are the lies that you've believed. And on the other side, write down the truth that would be God's response to every lie that you believe. Memorize the truth. Dwell in the truth. Occupy the truth. Inhabit the truth. Let the truth inhabit you, my friends. You deserve better than what shame gives you. The grace of God is so abundant and so exhaustive. To quote my friend and mentor, Brennan Manning, he said, "All is grace." There is grace for every situation. You know, earlier in a video, I alluded to a quote by a minister I heard years ago that said, "It's the olive that's pressed that releases the oil." I want to unpackage that statement a little bit in the way it relates to shame. Is that when we are pressed on all sides by shame, by guilt, by accusations, whatever it is, I pray that that pressure would only make your circumstances conform to the plans of God to ultimately set you free. You know, when we're pressed, what's in us comes out. And I pray that rather than, you know, when you're squeezed, when you're feeling squeezed by the circumstances of your life or the hard places of life, that what would come out of you instead of shame would be grace, would be love, would be any number of the fruits of the Spirit, all 9 fruits of the Spirit in operation in your life, rather than shame. You know, when your life is pressed, let the grace of God flow out of you. When the accusations come, let them bounce off you. When the fiery darts of accusation, temptation, wickedness, whatever it is that's bombarding your thought life or pressing up against your spiritual life, let the grace of God come out of you. Like the balm of Gilead, like the anointing of oil, let the presence of God just ooze out of you rather than shame. My friends, don't surrender your life to shame. Don't surrender your life to accusation, no matter how religiously justified it sounds. Read your own book, read the Bible, read the Gospels, and see for yourself how big the grace of God is. See for yourself, my beloved friends. with that, I'm going to sign off. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful day. And I just want you to know that God loves you and that I love you. Many blessings, friends.